Thank you, Ruth. Thank you for inviting me to be a part of this very distinguished panel. I'm happy to share with you this new research report that was produced by the World Bank's research division. Let me begin with a story derived from a documentary film made in India, because I think this will help set the stage and we can come back and refer to it when we get to the main messages of the report. So this documentary tells the story of the city of Kanpur in the north Indian state of Uttar Pradesh, which was once regarded as the Manchester of the East because of its thriving industry. Today it is without electricity and without industry, having fled because of lack of services and 16 hours of power cuts a day. The eponymous protagonist of the film, the Katyabas, which in Hindi means one who snips the electric wires to make illegal electric connections for households and steals electricity from the state, is pictured over here. And he describes how he learnt this quite hazardous trade from the frontline workers of the state public electric utility. Footage in the film also shows citizens justifying this theft from the state, even though they think theft in general is immoral, because the state and its leaders are corrupt. And these Katyabases have their incarnations in other places. For example, in Mexico, I believe they are known as Diabilitos. The second protagonist is this reforming public official who tries to fix the system by galvanizing her officers to crack down on illegal connections and to increase revenue collection from customers. But she becomes the target of great public ire and is eventually transferred to a backwater position. So this is a picture of her on her very festive farewell party. And the third protagonist is the politicians. A local leader rises to take advantage of this public discontent and positions himself successfully as a savior of the poor and the weak. He wins the state legislative assembly elections. And subsequently, while in office, he has been the subject of controversy and has had allegations of criminality and violence against him. And the city of Kanpur remains dark and decayed. So what this example serves to illustrate is the problem of politics, which is fundamental to governance and is tackled in the report. And this is a problem when the leaders who wield power in government deliberately fail to pursue sound public policies on the basis of technical evidence. So the report abstracts from what are indeed good technical policies in education or health or agriculture or any other sector, and focuses on governance as the process of pursuing policies on the basis of debating the best available technical evidence. And so it confronts the problem of adverse political incentives to ignore technical evidence and of perverse behavioral norms that are prevalent not only among political leaders, but also among bureaucratic leaders and indeed citizens themselves, as in the example I began with. So, of course, the report discusses extensively the example of corruption as a widespread government failure, particularly in poor countries. But it also goes beyond corruption and discusses how distributive conflict and ideological polarization among citizens everywhere in the rich and the poor world can contribute to government failures and prevent citizens from finding common ground for public goods, even in advanced economies with strong institutions to control corruption. And we then hone in and focus on two forces that are emergent around the globe to draw lessons for policymakers on how these two forces might be harnessed to address government failures. First is political engagement, which we define in the report as processes of citizen participation in selecting and sanctioning the leaders who wield power in government, including crucially by entering themselves as contenders for leadership. and we clarify how political engagement happens in every institutional context. This is not about democracies versus autocracies. And the second force is transparency, which we define as citizen access to publicly available information about the actions of those in government and the consequences of those actions. And in a moment, I'll show you some slides which just to put some flavor on something you probably already know about how we live in a world where information is being generated by diverse actors and broadcast and shared through new communication technologies. So the first panel here shows that institutions are spreading across the globe that provide greater space for citizens to engage as voters and contenders for leadership. So that top panel shows you data from the Polity 4 initiative and how the distribution of countries has shifted upward towards greater space for democratic institutions. So even if an individual country might have stagnated or indeed reversed over the years, what this picture shows is the distribution of countries has shown this secular shift upwards. The second panel is just one example of some case studies in the report documenting the spread of local political engagement, even within countries where the national political space might be closed. So here the example is Uganda, where the bar chart is documenting how the number of political contenders at the district level is three or more in most districts, and how the distribution of the share of winning votes in many places is skewed towards less than 50%. So this is real vigorous local competition and entry of citizens as contenders for leadership. Then we've used public opinion surveys to document that citizens who are likely to be poor as proxied by their years of education are likely to report voting in large numbers, and indeed more than the rich or the better educated, especially in the poor regions of the world, such as Africa and South Asia. Public opinion surveys show a pattern where citizens express that they feel their vote really matters for making a difference in their own lives and in whether their country develops. To move to transparency trends, let me begin with some evidence in Afrobarometer surveys in two countries, Uganda and Nigeria, where citizens were surveyed on the eve of elections. And they express, including the poor and food insecure, express a thirst for more information to decide how to evaluate and assess their leaders. The Gallup World Poll also shows that citizens across regions use multiple different types of media to access information. So for example, local radio is a particularly important source of information in the African region. This picture shows what some have called a dictator's dilemma, that because of the nature of information and communication technologies, the spread of transparency is difficult to control. Some of these technologies are needed for growth, and so dictators are reluctant to suppress them. But at the same time, they can be used by citizens to access information and communicate and coordinate with one another. So what the graph is showing is that while it is true that there's a positive correlation between measures of democracy as measured by Polity 4 and media freedom as measured by Freedom House, it is also the case that within any given level of autocracy or democracy, there's quite a fair bit of media freedom. And in fact, we also cover some research in the report which argues that even autocratic leaders have incentives to allow some degree of media freedom because it is helpful for them to hold their local level officials accountable. This picture comes from the website of Reporters Without Borders, and it color codes the world according to press freedom indicators, and results in this, what we think is quite surprising, specifically in that the African continent shows up looking much like the rest of the world, including countries that have the highest levels of press freedom, and including several countries that are indeed better than the United States or countries like Mexico and India. And this picture just says that it's not just media and investigative journalists, but civil society and international development partners are also generating information about the government. So information about the government is no longer in the exclusive purview and domain of governments, but have all of these other actors engaged in it. So here are the main messages of the report. First, political engagement is identified as the fundamental driver of governance. The selection and sanctioning of leaders is key to both understanding government failure and to solving it. So when politics is a problem, you can't bypass it. The solutions have to be found by going through it. Second, transparency can support and nourish political engagement so that they can work together to overcome government failures. And in contrast, transparency initiatives that try to bypass the political process are unlikely to be effective. And third, we recognize that elections are certainly a blunt instrument. The business of government happens in between elections and through a myriad working level government agencies. But we document and make forge connections between dispersed pieces of research to show that building these effective day-to-day institutions of government requires changes in political behavior. Investments in formal capacity and innovative technological solutions are not enough, and that political engagement and transparency can play a crucial role in bringing about these changes in behavior. We show in the theoretical framework of the report how political engagement casts a long shadow on governance. It shapes the incentives and behavior not only of political leaders, but also of bureaucrats, frontline providers, and citizens themselves. Again, think back to the example I set the stage with. And let me just use another way of conveying these main messages. Let's start with a simple proposition that transparency's impact really depends on what do people do with it. So the hope is that people will use transparency and initiatives for citizen engagement to solve collective action problems for the greater public good. And it's typically supported by external actors through these social accountability initiatives. The hope is we can bring well-intentioned people together, not just in civil society, but also public-spirited reform leaders in government. But the problem of politics is there are other types of collective action that special interest groups are very good at doing, which can thwart the collective action in the public interest. And these special interest groups, in fact, are quite savvy about using individual action of voters or citizens at large to oust reform leaders and replace them with their own private interest leaders, such as using things like caste, vote buying, or other targeted benefits. And again, it's not just vote buying and caste in poor countries, it's also populist demands from the so-called ordinary citizens out there that can be exploited by leaders who nurture ideological constituencies and polarize people rather than finding common ground. And so what we take away from the evidence is an understanding of citizen behavior and responsiveness to transparency so that policy actors can craft their strategies and shift it in the direction of a greater public good. And we call this public versus private good healthy and unhealthy behaviors in the report. And so how do you target transparency to nourish political engagement towards the healthy behaviors? I'm not going to read out this table. This is table 0.2 in the overview of the report, but it's a summary of all of the evidence. And I suppose there are two sentences in which I could summarize it. that the voice of ordinary citizens is amplified by political institutions, and the voice of reform leaders is amplified by access to mass media. You put these two things together and you get these policy implications of strategically targeted transparency, not just agnostic and generalized transparency, which requires producing, generating credible information content on performance of public policies and the consequences of policy actions. It's not just the information content that matters, but it's communication in entertaining and appealing ways through persuasive mass media. And finally, the congruence of both of these features at the level of political markets, at disaggregated jurisdictional levels where citizens are actively engaged in selecting and sanctioning leaders. Think about the Uganda example of the district level, where you might target this kind of information and communication. These are not easy solutions. Unhealthy political engagement can persist despite transparency. But what we are arguing is that there's no sidestepping it. And on a more optimistic note, we are sort of describing processes, historical processes of institutional transition on which there's some research to argue that the confluence of these two forces may provide tipping points for homegrown, sustainable institutional change. So I'll stop there because I can leave you just with this slide about where we think the policy directions are, and I'm delighted to be sharing it with you in this audience. Thank you.